Well, thank you all for showing. I appreciate the interest. I gave a talk, the same talk last night at the University of Oregon in Eugene, and it went over very well, and so I'll give the same one today. I spoke here, I don't know, I think I see a few familiar faces. I think maybe 3 years ago, might have been 4 years ago, and a lot's changed in the last few years in Oregon, with wolves especially. I'm going to try to touch on today all of these things, and I'm going to try to do it in about 45 minutes. That's a lot of stuff, and I could talk about this all day, and I'd love to, but I'll do my best, and then of course I'll give everybody chances to ask questions of me. One of the things that has changed, and one of the most notable changes, is just a few years ago when I would give a presentation like this, I would put up photos that I had from other states and other wolves. We didn't really have that many wolves. Every photograph in this presentation was taken in Oregon. And I'll try to tell you where they are, just because I know that there's probably some interest in here. This is the pups of the Imnaha pack last year, is what these are. So let's just dive right into this and talk about a few of the technical parts first, and we'll get into the better stuff in a minute. I think most of you know wolves are fully protected in the state of Oregon right now. They're protected under federal law in the light brown portion, which is two-thirds of Oregon, west of Highway 395. The darker brown portion in, I guess I have a pointer, in eastern Oregon is federally delisted, but wolves across the state of Oregon are protected by Oregon ESA. So that is important. And as you see, all of the known wolf packs in Oregon occur in the northeast part. I'll talk about a new possible wolf pack here shortly that you're all familiar with in a minute. So what does that mean? The federal government is planning to delist wolves in most of the lower 48, which would include this part of Oregon. That decision has not been made yet. We expect to see a record of decision sometime. We're thinking by this fall anyway, or at least that's what I'm told, but we don't know for sure. Oregon also has goals in our wolf plan to delist wolves as well at some point, and I'm going to try to touch on that a little bit in a minute. Probably one of the more common questions I get asked a lot is people have a lot of thoughts about wolves in Oregon, and by all different sides, I assure you, is why did we do this, or why don't we just do that with wolves, or what were we thinking when we decided that? The thing I want people to take away, I won't get too deep into our wolf plan, but I do want people to understand most all of the decisions that are made about wolves, and literally the sole part of my job is to implement a policy that was decided nearly 10 years ago, in 2005, 9 years ago. So Oregon has a plan that talks about how it's going to manage wolves now, while they're listed, and after they're listed, or after they're delisted, excuse me. That plan was adopted in 2005. It was a huge public involvement process. By the way, this is the Imnaha pack, and this pretty female right here is the alpha female of the Imnaha pack. And we've never seen her with our eyes. We've only seen her with photographs, and through genetics is why we know she's a breeder. The other strong part, or one strong part of our plan, I think also is, and all good plans really have a mechanism to reevaluate them. Ours is every 5 years, and that fifth year comes up next year in 2015. So we'll probably start a process. A public involvement process doesn't necessarily mean tossing the old plan in the garbage or tearing it apart and redoing it. What it is, an evaluation. When we evaluated in 2010, the last one, really we didn't have very many wool. We really hadn't tested a lot of the things that we use in our wolf plan. Now, of course, we have a growing and expanding wolf population. So this evaluation, we'll be able to take a little bit more of a look on exactly what's happening now and what works and what doesn't in that plan. I think that's a strong part of the plan, but it's also highly controversial, as you all know. Everything with wolves does seem to be. So that's all I'll say about the wolf plan, at least for now, and I'll answer any questions, but let's talk a little bit about what most people want to know. Where are we? When I talked to you folks or in this same room a few years ago, these numbers were a lot lower than what they are now. Incidentally, that is a Walla Walla pack wolf right there near the Washington border. That's probably the finest photograph we've ever captured on a trail cam, just a regular little trail cam. So, and that was just this last winter. So right now, we count wolves once a year, at the end of every year, and in 2013 then is this what this refers to. We have 8 packs, all of those, as I said before, are in Northeast Oregon. That's up from 6 the previous year. 4 breeding pairs, and breeding pairs are really the key part for us. Packs and wolf numbers that come and go, but breeding pairs really are the parameter that we measure. There's what tell us how these wolves are, how they might fare into the future, how many young we're seeing recruited into the adult population. It's really a better measurement for health of a population, is successful breeding pair. Before I get too far down with breeding pairs, I do want to say one thing. Just in the last couple of weeks with this news about OR7 having a mate, and clearly he has bred, and they're raising pups. It doesn't necessarily mean by this definition that that is a breeding pair. There's kind of a technicality here. A breeding pair, by our definition, denotes success. So it means that wolves have had pups, and at least 2 of those pups were successful throughout the calendar year. So when I say 4 breeding pairs in Oregon last year, that means that there was at least 2 pups in those 4 pairs that survived through December. So it's a little tricky. OR7 and his new girlfriend are not a breeding pair yet. By definition. 17 known pups, and I also want to say with the 4 breeding pairs, that's a decline from 6 the previous year. And I'll talk a little bit in a minute about why that decline occurred. But wolf populations fluctuate a little bit too, they oscillate. And 64 known wolves, which is probably the least important out of all of that, but it's still an important figure, I suppose. To me, I won't get too deep into graphs and all that because I don't necessarily like them. Again, we count wolves once a year, but I do want to illustrate and make sure folks understand that these packs, oftentimes people refer to these wolf packs almost like humans, almost like families. It's a family today, it'll be a family tomorrow, it'll be a family the next day. They're not, they're very dynamic. Packs come and packs go, and they split apart and new members come, and there's a lot of killing between and within them. And so these packs have a tremendous dynamic to them. What is important about this, though, to me, more than anything, is the shape of this graph. If many of you will remember, a few years ago, I showed a graph of the Northern Rocky Mountain wolf population. It was going up on an exponential curve. What we're seeing right now is our wolf population is doubling in Oregon about every 2 years, and that just mirrors exactly what happened with the rest of the Northern Rocky Mountain. So what does that tell us? Wolves in Oregon are probably successful, or they will be, and they appear to show signs that they're just as successful as the rest of the Northern Rocky Mountains. Again, we did have a drop in the breeding pairs in 2013. That's not too alarming to me, even though it might be to some, and I'll explain why in a moment. Visual representation of where they are. Most of these wolves are in Wallowa County and a little bit in Umatilla County and a part of Union County, but the rest of them in Wallowa County. What you see here is this is something that you didn't see a few years ago when I was here. You're really seeing a filling up of habitats. Again, mirror image of Idaho, Montana, Northeast Wyoming when wolves were reintroduced there. These are all non-reintroduced wolves, but they're filling up habitat. Where you see round circles such as this one, we don't really have any data for that pack. We know they're there, we just don't know anything about them yet, it's still pretty new. The rest of these irregular shaped polygons come from actual data from radio collars, GPS collars, and I'm gonna talk at length about those in just a moment. The newest 2 packs are this pack here that was just discovered last winter and the Mount Emily pack. And this pack is actually gonna prove very useful for us as well and some research that we're starting up. I haven't done this before ever until last night, but I did want to take a couple of seconds and just talk about what a wolf looks like. I receive hundreds, literally 300 to 400 wolf reports a year. Of course, most of those aren't wolves. Some of them are, most of them aren't. And most often, wolves are very confused with coyotes. Most people, even if you like wolves and study them, most people in this room will never see a wolf. It's not that they are secretive, and so when they do see them, sometimes it's just a fleeting glimpse that you don't get a great view, but I do want to point out a couple of things. Of course, the 2 on the right are coyotes, And what distinguishes these coyotes in virtually any color phase, any size, male or female, are these almost grotesquely long ears. They really stand out. Ears, pointed snout, pretty dainty legs. You go over to wolves on the other side, you see very long legs, they're very leggy. Some of them are very stout legs. This is a female, this is a male. And of course, just the stature of the males is pretty difficult to miss. But at the same time, what you see shorter ears, rounded ears, you see broad face and a very broad snout. Even in a dainty 63-pound wolf, which is what this is the alpha female of the Umnaha pack, even then she still has a pretty hefty head on her that you just don't see on coyotes. The wolf up here is a Snake River wolf, and this is a Walla Walla wolf. What most people that spend very much time out in the woods, though, what they will see, may not see wolves, but they will see tracks. You take a pack of wolves and you multiply it by four, and you put about 10 to 20 miles a day on them, and you start to realize how many tracks get put down on the ground. And in the wintertime, it's actually quite easy to find tracks if you're in an area with wolves. This picture, and I apologize for it, I thought it might show up a little bit better, but I probably get 2 to 6 photographs a week from people that have a track that says, here's a wolf track. Almost always what they're showing me are cougar tracks. And cougar tracks are very, very easy to distinguish. The first thing in snow with cougar tracks, you see this halo around this track. You see it in almost every track, and you don't see that here. Even at this angle, you would see those halos around this track at a gross level, and that's because of the fur around a cougar track. Big cougars, small cougars, they all leave a halo in deep snow. The other thing you'll notice is very small toe pads in relation to the size of the track, kind of little pear-shaped toes. Big space between the proximal pad, which is this pad here, and the toes. You see that space? That's very characteristic of cats. Most of the time, cats don't leave claws in the snow, but sometimes they do, and that can be a little bit deceiving. But you see on that right-hand one, that cougar track does not. That's just a real easy to pick out. The other thing cougars do is they meander when they walk. Wolves are very linear walkers. Whenever they're traveling, the line always seems to be nearly straight. Yeah, they turn a little bit, but then they go straight, and then they turn and go straight. Cougars will just literally foot after foot kind of meander around. So the other thing with wolves, of course, the claws, big toes, different shape of a proximal pad that you see here. If you have a really nice track, that little M shape right here in the back is very distinguishable. Wolf tracks, dog tracks are also longer than they are wide, almost always. Cougar tracks are about the same width, width to length. They're kind of a square track. This photograph you see right here probably represents wolf better than anything that I can show with the track. And that's because wolves have a distinct capability of putting their hind foot directly into their front foot. That's why this looks like a two-legged animal. It was just walking, and they put them right in line. They're fairly narrow-chested. Even a large wolf is narrow-chested, and they're kind of knock-kneed, and so they walk like this. So these tracks are 24 inches apart, which is a very common spacing like that. A walking track, just a directly registered track. This is the same wolf here. So if you see a track like that out in the woods, very few domestic dogs can do that. If you see a track set like that, you're almost assuredly looking at some type of wolf anyway. So let's switch and talk a little bit about when we talk about these polygons of wolves and where wolves are and what we know and how we count them, a number of breeding pairs, how do we know all of that stuff? These are secretive large carnivores, and again, I see very few on my own account, very, very few. It's just not that common. So they're not easy to count. They're not easy to follow. They're not easy to understand how they move around unless you do one thing, and that's put a collar on them. And of course, the collar is how we know OR7 in the newspapers. It's how we know a lot of things that make news and create some kind of public interest about wolves. Can everybody hear me in the back, by the way? Okay. So capture and monitoring these wolves becomes very important. There's another reason it's important is because in that wolf plan I referred to a little bit ago, The wolf plan has a lot of promises. It has a lot of goals and objectives, things that it says we're going to do. And most of those, especially related to populations, listing status, future management, have to do with the population. And in order to know what you have, you have to be able to monitor it. This is really the tool of choice then, is putting these collars on. We also monitor in a number of ways. We follow up on these public reports. A lot of people don't know that when they send we have an online reporting system, we get hundreds a year. When you get on there and you fill out a wolf report that says, I saw a wolf and it was big and ugly or whatever, we actually follow up on that some way or another. Doesn't mean we jump in a truck and go out in the field. Some of these wolf reports don't have a lot of information. But if it is likely something, we do our best to follow up. And we find a lot of wolves over the years, at least, that way. Track surveys and trail cameras. Well, trail cameras are what took those recent pictures of OR7 that made the newspaper. So that's an important tool as well. Following up on tracks surveys is also very important. Probably the most fascinating thing to me right now is genetic sampling from either scat or tissue samples. Go back 10 years ago even, 8 years ago when I first started into this position, we couldn't even tell from a genetic sample if it was a wolf. We couldn't separate wolf from dog. Now, not only can we separate wolf from dog, we can separate wild wolf from hybrid wolf. We can tell the sex of the animal from genetics, and we can tell the source population. So if it came from Idaho or if it came from other Oregon wolf packs, we can actually tell it now. That's really neat stuff, and it really allows us, just like identifying the alpha female of that Winnaha pack, that nice, pretty white or dark-faced white wolf, that was done through genetics. So pretty neat stuff. We collect samples off of every animal that we put in our hands. By the way, this is OR4, the alpha male of the Winnaha pack, and that is the third time we captured that particular wolf, and we've since captured him again. He goes through collars like they're candy, no, unfortunately. The collars are $3,500 each, too, so we're getting a little tired of it. last year, we caught 8 wolves in the state of Oregon. That's about what we've done the last few years, in fact. So that wolf was caught by helicopter capture, and I'll describe that in just a minute, a little bit more. So when we put these collars on, that's the alpha male of the Winnaha pack right there, and he was caught by trapping. When we put these collars on, these are a different kind of collar than what some are used to. Many of you remember, you know, kind of the radio collar that we have an antenna and it beep, 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 and we listen and we can kind of close in or tell a direction. These are a little bit different. These are GPS collars. They essentially operate on simple processes, just like your handheld GPS that some of you may use out in the woods or people use when they jog or for a lot of different purposes. The difference, though, with these collars is these collars actually talk to the satellite. They have two-way communication. So that's not a very new technology, even though it's widely used in the last 5 years. But that ability to send store data, locational data, send that data to a satellite, it goes to a computer in Germany, and then it comes to my computer in about a tenth of a second. It's really incredibly fast, and so that changes the whole playing field. If you look at the right-hand graph, these are locational dots of a wolf in about a month of time. And it's kind of tough to tell. It's not really that important, the numbers. It's 4 or 5 miles across here. But you see tremendous movement, lots of random-like movements, areas of heavy use. I can assure you that's more data in that month than we could collect flying an aircraft 3 times a week for 2 years. We wouldn't get that much data. So these collars they're very expensive, but they also then allow us to collect so much more data. And in fact, it's that type of data that where we know where OR7 is and how he traveled and when he went to Sacramento and all that stuff. So unfortunately, though, I do have to say one thing about these collars. Besides being expensive, and that's a big part of wolf management, is expensive, they have a high failure rate. This collar on this very wolf right here functioned for about a month before it failed. And it's not because the collars are not built correctly. These are probably the best collars made. What it is wolves live a very rough lifestyle. Can you imagine chasing down a herd of elk through woods, that collar whacking on things like rocks and logs or maybe hooves kicking at it? They just take a tremendous beating. When we've recovered some of our collars, they're really beat up bad. So it's a very, we're starting to become dependent on these collars to get the information we require. At the same time, there's quite a cost to it in capture, just to keep them on. The other difficulty with these collars then is keeping these packs collared. Remember, I said these packs are very dynamic. They don't stay the same. The pack is essentially an extended family unit is what it is. It's adult wolves, and usually some levels or generations of offspring make up a pack. Not that often are new wolves incorporated into a pack, into an established pack. But one thing that does happen regularly, besides death, birth, death, is dispersal. And dispersal takes some of these collars out too. Here's an example. Just last winter, we had three of these GPS collars, and you probably recognize the photo on the wolf there. Three of these GPS collars, this is the Walla Walla pack, this big glob up here. Within 1 month, all three of these collars left the pack. One of them went to northern Idaho, one of them went over just north of Boise, and another one made a very short dispersal, and that's OR11, which is this wolf right here. And OR11 is now the breeding alpha male of the Mount Emily pack that I referred to, right in this area. So at the same time, that's neat stuff, neat information. It's amazing to watch these wolves travel across the landscape. At the same time, then, we're left with a pack with no information. We have another pack here that we can't really say where it is or how many and things like that. So when Tim gave my introduction, you saw the photo of me holding the wolf in the rock pile. That wolf just dispersed from the Snake River pack a month ago, and he's now just outside of Missoula, Montana. These wolves really travel. So OR7 is not the only the only traveler in the bunch. We have another one that's made his way to the Ochocos just a couple of days ago.
That means its way to where?
I'm sorry? Ochocos, which is in east central Oregon.
Which
yep.
one?
Yep. I'm sorry?
Which one?
This is a wolf OR24 out of the Snake River pack. Yep. Of course, OR7 is a more publicized and one that many of you folks, especially on this side of the mountain, are familiar with because it's closest to you and has created a tremendous amount of interest both across our country and even worldwide to an extent. It's been interesting to see the interest. But of course, that wolf, he was born in 2010 in the Mnaha pack. I did put the collar on that wolf, so we monitored him from the beginning. It gives you a rough idea of the travel path of that wolf. It's about a 5 mile wide swath across Oregon. And of course, what's interesting of this, look at the dates, September 10 through November 19. A month and 9 days, this wolf did that. Then of course, subsequently, he went almost to Sacramento, spent about a year in California, and he came back a year ago spring. And now of course, the wolf is in this area right here with his new mate. So pretty interesting story. Many of you have seen these photos. I think they created quite a lot of interest. And again, these photos were captured because of the data from the collar that's hanging around his neck. And that data allows us to know where he is, know where how to go put these cameras up to where we can actually potentially, we believe there was a female there. We can see a cluster. And I'm asked this all the time, how do we know he's mated? Or how do we know he's bred? Well, when you see these clusters of dots go from 300 square miles to six, you can kind of tell. Especially starting about the third week of April, which is when pups are born. It's pretty clear. We don't just go on hunches, though. We like solid information. When we talk about these numbers that I put up, we actually can verify that information. So that's why the cameras went up. These cameras were put up by U.S. Fish. Wolf folks over there, we coordinate with them quite regularly and captured the photos of the two of the black female. It's the same wolf, by the way. That picture and that picture is the same wolf, at least as best we can tell. Hopefully we'll be able to get, and I'm asked all the time, where do we think she came from and who is she and those types of questions. Hopefully we'll be able to answer those. All we have to do is collect one scat. People can't quite figure me out why I get so excited about collecting wolf turds and didn't used to, but I do now. And a lot of it's because we can tell so much information from just a good DNA sample of this wolf. And, it, and in that situation, we can do it without having to capture the animal or put our hands on the animal. So a lot of information can be gained. Of course, we already have information on him. He very much looks like he has a belly full of food here, by the way, because he's normally not that heavy. People ask, I probably get talk about OR7 for a minute. I've never talked about the capture of OR7, but I get asked probably more than any other thing about capturing that particular wolf. And the second question I get more than any is, why don't we have any pictures of that wolf? You see me with these pictures of these collared wolves, and yet I don't have any of OR7. Well, there's a reason for that. I did capture that wolf. We did it by helicopter capture, and that helicopter, I'm in it, and it's flying in about an hour after I put the collar on OR8, and it's about 5 degrees below zero while that photo's taken. So, extraordinarily cold. When we do these captures, the first thing we do is take care of the animal, do the things we have to do, and put the collar on. When we took off that morning, it was 13 below zero, warmed up to 5 degrees, and there's no door on the other side of that helicopter. And so I was so cold, it was just all I could do to get the wolf taken care of. And by the time I was done, I couldn't feel my camera. I couldn't even operate it. That's why there's no photographs of OR7. It's the only wolf that we don't have photographs of in our hand, and that's the reason. So that picture kind of says a lot there. Talk a little bit about capture, and I've never really done it. There's two ways we catch wolves. One is foothold trapping. Traditional trapping methods, really, that trappers have used for many, many years, and the other is helicopter capture. I will tell you right up front, I prefer trapping methods. I think it's much safer on the wolf, and it's much safer on me or the biologists that are doing the captures. But typically, when we're trying to catch multiple wolves, we'll have a fixed-wing aircraft up high, which is what took the photo on the right. And the reason is then I can dart multiple wolves if they're available, and the fixed wing can circle around and keep track of them, know where they go before, because they generally will run off before they conk out. And that way we can find them and don't lose them. So there's actually, in that photograph, there is a sleeping wolf right there, and we're just getting out of the helicopter to go take care of it. But essentially what we do is sit on the same side as the pilot in this. It's very, very cold. And point the gun right out so that the pilot can see the tip of the barrel right out of his window. And really, the pilot is what puts the gun barrel right next to the wolf, and we're able to get him. So that's kind of a real quick rundown of helicopter capture. It's pretty disruptive, I'm sure. A lot of other things go into these captures. When we put an animal on the ground, there's a lot of things to do, starting from the well-being of the animal. That's kind of a paramount importance. As soon as we have either a trapped or an immobilized animal, there's a lot of responsibility to make sure that that animal's taken care of, because they can't take care of themselves. So if there's water nearby, or sometimes they conk out near a stream or in a stream, things like that, we have to be very careful and very quick about it. So there's a lot of preparation. We have veterinarians, which is what this fella here is, helping us mix drugs, getting things ready in the morning. We go out, we do the darting work. And we actually, both of these wolves, this is OR4, the first time he was captured. This is OR3. And both of those wolves were darted almost together and ended up conking out within a couple of hundred yards of each other. But you can see in these, there's a lot of care that goes in, protecting their eyes, taking all of the information that we do before we put that collar on. So it's kind of an interesting and a fairly exciting process. I'm going to switch now and talk about the not-so-fun, that was the fun side of wolf management, and now here's the not-so-fun side. I have to preface this by saying something. A lot of people have in their mind that maybe most of my job entails what I just talked about, capture and monitoring, and I have all these photographs. The plain simple truth of it is, in Oregon, 90% of my job and our wolf resources go to this issue right here. 90% of it. Very seldom do we actually go out and capture wolves, and that doesn't take very long. Most of our time and resources go to the issue of livestock depredation. So when you go back over the course of 2013 and you look at this, we did 41 investigations. And what that is anytime somebody has a dead or injured livestock animals, sheep, goat, cattle most of the time, they call us if they suspect wolf, and we go and look and make a determination on what we think killed, was it wolf or was it not. Out of those 41, as you see, not all of them turn out to be. We confirmed 13 incidences of depredation. That's either death or injury of these animals. You're looking at a couple of photos right here, or a photo on the right of wolf killed sheep. Wolf jumped into this sheep pen and killed a bunch of sheep. That's what they do. The experts always said that wolves would kill livestock. They have, and they will, and they will continue to. The trick of all this is, how do we manage that? And it's not a very pleasant process, I assure you. There are some tools that we use when we do have depredation, some non-lethal tools. This is called fladry. And this nice little lady right here had these dead sheep. It was a tent situation, but she has been religious about using that fladry, and those wolves have been around her sheep for the last year and a half since that depredation, have not jumped back into that pen. So some of these tools actually do work fairly well. Others don't. And not all tools work all of the time, and people shouldn't be jaded in. I'll answer any questions if you don't mind when we're done, but hold that thought. I do want to say another thing too, because this is important. You look at 13 confirmed incidences, and I suspect there's people in this room thinking, so in the whole state of Oregon we had 13 wolf kills. You know, what's the big deal? That's really a low number. There's more than 13 depredated livestock in every county in every month of every year. That's the fact of the matter. This is a low number. But here's the deal. If you're a rancher, this is sort of a new animal, at least to our generation. We've been several generations without wolves. So this is a fairly new animal to many people. Those other depredations still occur. And if you're a rancher that is having this depredation, it is an important thing. And therefore, it becomes important to all of us, Oregon's public and us as a managing agency. So I do want to make sure, even though that number is still pretty low, and it didn't really increase too awful much. There was 8 incidences the previous year. Our population increased, and there were a few more. And that's primarily because one particular pack then decided to depredate. That was the Snake River pack in 2013. So the other really not so fun part of this is what happens when you have continued problems with wolves, when you have continued depredation. You do measure, you take measures, you try to solve the problem non-lethally. But one of the things our plan has, and every wolf management program in the union has, is provisions to lethally remove wolves in problem situations. We think as an agency that's an important tool to have, and I think it's an important tool to have. Remember, Oregon is a developed landscape. We have very few areas where wolves will not be in contact with either livestock or humans. So because of that, we should expect more conflict than maybe some other areas even, such as in Idaho, that has large backcountry expanses, places where wolves really aren't around people very much. We're going to have proportionally probably more depredation than some of these other states. We'll be dealing with that. So what happens when we have a problem and it continues? We have a chronic problem. One of the things that occurred last year, or a couple of years ago, through a lawsuit and a subsequent settlement, was a new rule, essentially a new law, statutory law and new rule. And there's a lot to it, and I could spend a whole day talking about that. It's very complex and not that fun to listen to. But there is some important things. One is we have a plan and a rule that says how we're going to deal with depredation, right? When this was made a year ago this month, essentially what it did was replaced all that. So everything in our old plan is no longer as far as this subject, lethal control. When do we kill a wolf? The new rule applies. Some of the more important changes, and there's actually quite a number of them, but these are probably the most talked about and the most recognized. One is changing the definition of chronic. Chronic is really the trigger then for lethal control. And that's from four depredations. It used to be 2. But here's the really important one. I don't think going from 2 to 4 is all that of a huge issue. But within 6-month period is really a change. It's really kind of a landmark change. What it does is it sort of signifies, for lack of a better way to say it, it signifies a rate of predation, depredation by wolves that's acceptable. If you stay under that rate of 4 in 6 months, then lethal control doesn't become an option. That's a tough pill for some folks to swallow, as you can probably imagine. At the same time, we have not had any lethal control that really hasn't been even on the table since this was made. The other thing that it does, and this is also a very important thing, is it mandates non-lethal measures as a condition for lethal control and defines which depredations qualify. In other words, not all depredations qualify. So a rancher might have a dead cow, and I might stand over it and say, yep, this is a wolf-killed cow. However, that's not the end of the story. It may not qualify under this rule if the person didn't do some non-lethal measures. And there's different scenarios under which they need to them. Now, I do have to say this. This rule doesn't tell anybody or any rancher that they have to do non-lethal measures. There's an important distinction. They don't have to do any of this, and there's a lot of, not a lot, but a few of them that will say, look, I don't like these wolves, I didn't want them, I'm not gonna do any of this, and that's fine. They're perfectly their right, and our agency is not gonna to tell anybody that otherwise. But what it does say is in order for lethal control to be an option, there does have to be non-lethal measures used. So that's a grossly abbreviated version of the rule. For that, I do apologize, but you can get on our website if you're really interested in all the details about it and read that. The other thing that this does is something that our original wolf plan called for when we made it, and that was it does allow now through Oregon statute, this was done by the legislature, for a livestock producer to shoot a wolf if it's attacking their livestock, endangered or not. And this is at least state endangered. In federally endangered Oregon, you can't do that. But in that brown eastern third of Oregon, you can. And I think that's an important thing as well. It's very rare, by the way, for that to occur. Most people are not going to see a depredation of any kind, let alone depredation of livestock. But if it does happen, they do have an ability to protect their livestock. The definition of attack is very strict. Essentially means the animal has to be in the act of attacking right then, not having attacked or attacked last night and now we're to this, has to be happening right now, I guess is the point I'm trying to make. One other thing about Oregon, and I've always said, and some of you have heard me when I've given other talks, I've always thought that one of the things that wolves need in the state of Oregon is to become normal. Wolves are often held out as special animals by both polar extremes, actually, very special animals. And I think the best thing that could ever happen to wolves if we normalize them. We do have a compensation program in Oregon, and unfortunately, it is the only wildlife species in our state that there is compensation for. So instead of normalizing, we've kind of continued to hold wolves special. At the same time, it has helped a lot of folks. It's not just a compensation program for paying for dead livestock, it's also a proactive fund. So last year, about $7,000 of the money that was in this program was spent on actual payment for dead wolf-killed livestock. The other 50-some thousand dollars was spent on non-lethal measures and proactive measures. So that's a positive thing as well. This program is run through the Department of Agriculture, not our agency. And really, all I have is two roles in this. One is to confirm depredation. Our agency, not just me, a lot of our folks do this. ODFW has to say if it is a wolf kill or not in order to qualify for any sort of compensation under this program. And the other thing is what we already do and what I've showed you on some of the map, and that's delineate areas that we know wolves occur. So people, livestock producers within these areas are eligible for compensation then under this. So that's a real abbreviated version of that. I have to put this in. If I would have shown this photograph a couple of years ago, I'd have been hung. I'm quite certain of it. But in fact, this is up in the Walla Walla Pack area, and these are kind of two jousting landowners on that fence line right there. And I always kind of thought that was funny. And really, it kind of is an interesting change. If you go back to 2010 and 2011, and now you actually, these folks that own both of those are not real enamored with wolves, I assure you, but at least there's a little bit of levity about it, I suppose. Maybe that's a good thing. Another thing that we monitor closely is different types of take and also dead wolves, when we have them or know of them. Take is not always a death of an animal. Take can be a capture of an animal. So in 2013, we had three wolves which were incidental caught. And these are caught, not intended to be caught. Two of those were by coyote trappers, and the other one was by a government trapper. And so in all three of those cases, we do have a system in play right now, and Oregon's pelt trappers, like coyote trappers, bobcat trappers, have been very good. We've gotten a lot of word out. They know if they do have one. They also know some ways to not catch one, but if they do, they call us. And in fact, both cases that happened, we were able to go get these wolves out of the trap, put a radio collar on them. That's actually a wolf that has since dispersed to Idaho. So these incidental captures are unfortunate, but at the same time, something positive can come of them. We also have had wolves that have been killed in Oregon. In December, we had a wolf that in Umatilla County that was found shot. That's the third wolf in the last 4 years that have been found shot. And so that's an important, that case is still pending, so I'm not gonna really talk too much about it. These wolves are protected. Killing them for whatever reason is just not allowed, other than the one statute that I referred to a minute ago, where they're attacking livestock. We also had something that was new, and I talked about going from 6 breeding pairs to 4 breeding pairs. One of the causes for that was parvovirus. Parvovirus is a common, I think most of you know, it's in our domestic dogs. We inoculate our dogs for parvovirus. We can't really inoculate a wild animal effectively, and so wolves are very susceptible, just like domestics are. And again, we live in a developed landscape, so do these wolves. There's human contact, even in some of what we consider to be kind of some remote area, isn't all that remote for a wolf. And so because of that, parvo probably will play a role as well in Oregon. We documented 2 deaths, and essentially what we documented was 2 complete litters lost in Oregon to parvo. Parvo ravages through pups, especially recently weaned pups are the most vulnerable, or about to wean, so that's a very important thing. Parvo also went through Yellowstone, and most populations of wolves in the northern Rocky Mountains is fairly common. It's been shown to kind of depress the growth rate, maybe even make it stagnant for a year or two, but it's really never been shown to be a huge detriment to a population. Yellowstone still has a healthy population of wolves, even though it had a parvo problem. So I think I'm not too concerned about it. Most longtime wolf experts aren't too concerned about parvo. It just seems to be there, and you have to deal with it. So. Last thing I'm going to talk about before I have another little treat at the end here for you, and that is another provision in our wolf plan that talks about understanding how wolves interact on our landscape. Deer and elk are important to Oregonians. They're important to this agency. They're important to hunters. They're important to a lot of folks for a lot of different reasons. And as a hunter myself, they're very important to me. Really then, understanding how wolves interact on a landscape that hasn't had wolves for a while, now we do, is going to be very important. It's going to be important for us to monitor these deer and elk population. That really is the primary prey for wolves. They eat other things, but they don't depend on literally any other thing other than ungulate prey. So understanding how wolves interact here is going to be important. We embarked on a project about a year ago to take a hard look at all of the contemporary research on wolves that has occurred in the northern Rocky Mountains, actually most of our continent, and even other parts of the world. We looked at 141 papers. We even contacted the researchers, did a lot of discussion, and it was a pretty ambitious project, but really the litmus that we were holding this to was, okay, that's what you found in your study. We know wolves eat meat everywhere, right? That doesn't change, but how does it apply to Oregon? What are some things that Oregon has that might be different? If Oregon's not different, we don't need to be looking at any of this, right? If wolves did what X or Y in some other state and we have the same type of environment, then we don't need to reinvent a wheel. What is really interesting, though, when we started looking at this, is looking at the difference, and there are some incredible differences that Oregon has that almost everywhere else that wolves have been studying in the lower 48 don't have. One of them is we have very mild winter climate, believe it or not. Most all of the northern Rocky Mountain states where wolves have been studied have very severe winters. We actually have a relatively mild winter. We also have very large winter ranges compared to some of those Rocky Mountain areas. Different predator and prey composition. In all of the northern, and I'll just give you examples, in all of the northern Rocky Mountains where wolves have been studied, elk are the primary prey. Interestingly, elk are also the most abundant prey. Well, in Oregon, it is different. Even in northeast Oregon or pieces of Oregon, deer are our most abundant prey. We also have two species of deer. One of them's a fairly robust population of white-tailed deer in northeast Oregon where these wolves are. So you start to look at that and think about it. They're not just depending necessarily on elk, but they have other, you know, what are impacts to these populations if, or is it ameliorated by having some of these other prey species? Other northern Rocky Mountain, I could go on with a lot of examples. Grizzly bears, high densities of grizzly bears. Grizzly bears have tripled their population in the northern Rockies in the last 15 years. We don't have grizzly bears, so there's one less predator. Some of the recent research that we did in Northeast specifically, where these wolves are, the Mount Emily unit that I referred to, really showed almost a singular importance of cougars in regulating our elk population. We have probably the highest densities of cougars in Oregon in our history right now. Maybe the highest density of black bears too, but clearly cougars at a very high level. Well, wolves and cougars interact, right? There's probably a reason why a cougar jumps in a tree when a dog barks at him. And I think it's 10,000 years of these things being around them. So really some important differences that, that really perked our interest. We also have fairly low hard antlerless elk harvest, especially levels right now, and deer. When wolves were put into the northern Rockies, into Yellowstone and central Idaho, both of those states had very high levels of antlerless elk harvest. They were trying to reduce those elk populations. There was way too many elk in some areas. So some of these are important differences, and really then they, what they did is said, we really do need to be looking at wolves here where we are, not necessarily reinventing a wheel, but we need to be looking and monitoring our wolves in relation to our deer and elk. So starting this summer, we have an Oregon State University project. A PhD student is on board now. It's going to be a four-year project, and we're going to be looking at some of the very things I just talked about, kind of the basic parameter, just how, what are these wolves eating, how often are they eating, prey selection, different areas. Also, we just, since we have some of the largest data sets of cougars and elk in the same area together right now of anywhere in the country, right where these wolves are just starting, there's a really nice opportunity then to look what happens when you put wolves into that equation as well. So, and then of course, looking at how do elk and deer respond when the wolves come in, because Mount Emily, that pack just started up this last winter, literally is a brand new pack, right on top of this study area. So really capitalizing on some nice opportunities, I think, for research, and I think it'll be important. I think the information we get from that is going to be extremely important as we get more and more wolves. Right now, our wolf numbers really aren't very high. 64 wolves in a northeast part of the state is a fairly low density, but that too will likely change. So I'm going to close, I guess. I'm going to end with a little video clip here in just a second, but I do want to say, you know, kind of a duh statement, we have more wolves. That's not unexpected. Both distribution and numbers. If we look at the other states where wolves came from, what we saw, you know, on any given piece of landscape, the density of wolves doesn't change that much. The reason the numbers go up is because the number of packs keep increasing, and we're starting to see the same thing in Oregon. We're implementing our plan. We do have an evaluation coming up here next year, and I think that'll be an interesting time in itself, but we're implementing that plan again. You know, we got kind of stymied when we went through the process of the legal process and the mediation process. Our plan is, it's a little bit different now, but we are implementing it. And of course, it's challenging, and when I say that, wolf management is expensive. It's not just challenging for us, it's also challenging for people that might be on the other end of having wolves in their area, such as what you see on the right. So it's challenging for a number of reasons, and I think wolves are just going to be a challenging species into the future for quite some time. Some of you may have seen a video. I'm going to play this video. Before I play it, though, I do want to say, some of you might have seen this. This is a video of the Snake River pack howling. This video, what you don't know is it was taken by my assistant, And she is actually as close to this wolf as it looks like she is. She's about 10 yards from it. And the reason we're asked a lot, how did she get that close to a whole pack of wolves? This pup that you see in this photograph right here, that starts this howling, was sound asleep. So she literally just walked up to the pup when it was sound asleep, and that's how she got so close. The other thing you don't see in this video is there's a black pup sitting about 5 yards right behind her, watching her as well. But what you will hear in this is you will hear a lot of different howls, and you'll get a feel for, many of you may never, in this room may have never heard a howl, you'll get a feel for the different voices of these wolves, just like humans. They have all kinds of different voices. Females generally are more feminine sounding, and you'll pick those out in this chorus howl. The pups are a little bit higher. You'll also hear the dominant alpha male in here that's very distinctive. I hope that this is loud enough. We couldn't get our system to be very loud, but I hope this is loud enough to hear.
And this is the Snake
Snake River pack in July. So these are three-month-old pups, really. And this is a pup. I'm hoping we can hear it. Everybody hear that? It might be hard to hear the others. I wish it was louder. Wolf howls generally are very long, too. They have a lot of wind. Unfortunately, you can't hear the male. He's actually off to the left. He's a very loud and low sound. The other wolves you hear are about 70 yards away in those trees. Typical youngster. Actually, a lot more howling in this than it's. I apologize for the lack of sound. There's a lot more howling. But. That's a typical female sound in the back, adult female. The snake, some packs are actually more vocal than others, and the Snake River pack's a very vocal pack. And when I put a radio collar on a black youngster out of that pack, and while I was collaring, the entire pack was just literally all around, probably not more than about 80 or 100 yards away, and they all just howled the entire time, almost deafening, really? Is how loud they were. Yeah, and what was really interesting, I thought, okay, they're going to wait for this wolf, and I did my thing and let it go. And by the time I was done, they all left. Just left it there. So, pretty funny. That's all I have. I'd be glad to answer any questions if you have any for me. Been a great audience. Yeah.
One is just a comment that looks so much older than a 3 month old.
Yeah, they do. Wolves are fast growers. That wolf there in that video is probably about 30 pounds, between 30 and 35 pounds. So it's probably about coyote. Adult coyote size. Yep.
And my question, back to when you have the photo of the dead sheep in the sheep pen,
yeah.
I was wondering why they didn't eat more of a particular sheep instead of just killing, I don't know how many they killed, we saw at least two.
Right, they ate some of several of them, and several they didn't hardly, well, they didn't eat at all, and that's actually not uncommon. In fact, that's not uncommon for about all predators. Bears, cougars, often predation is an event that occurs out of opportunity, and so you get a predator, whether it's a cougar, and we've seen this with cougars as well, you get a predator in an opportunity. Remember, there's a risk in capturing any animal or killing an animal. If you're a predator of any kind, there's a risk in what you do. You risk getting your teeth kicked in or your skull crushed or whatever. Even a wolf has that. So these aren't all supreme animals. So when they do have opportunity and the opportunity is going well, oftentimes then they'll just keep going. So, of course, we've seen more than 20 sheep in a pen, and sheep are pretty easy. But even with cattle, we've seen two adult cows killed and only some of one really eaten. So that's one answer for it. The other thing is remember that these animals oftentimes will kill, and we hear people talk about how they kill and just leave. They don't eat. But remember, in a natural setting, almost always they would come back and eat. It might be a week later, or it might be 2 weeks later, but they do eat these animals. So, yep. Yes, ma'am.
So also back to the sheep. So that little fancy thing that repels the wolves that lady put up, how does that work exactly?
Good question. She's asking about the flattery. The little fence, red flagging fence, is really an electrified wire with strips of flagging hanging off. And really, nobody knows why it deters wolves very well, but it's actually been a known deterrent well outside of our country for more than 100 years in parts of Scandinavia and Europe, so is where the idea came from. So the idea is, there's been some little pieces of video that shows wolves, they just don't like to cross it. Nobody really knows. The electrified wire part of it helps reinforce that a little bit, too. We call that turbo flattery, is what we call it. So, yeah, the thing to remember about all, and I think I mentioned this, all of these non-lethals can work, and all of them don't work all the time, even flattery. So there's uses for this that are proper. You have a situation like the sheep pen, and I'm going to do something here. You have a situation like the sheep pen, and I have to put up my last picture, so. There. That's the Winnaha pack wolf. You have a situation like a sheep pen, that's actually more of a protectable area. It works real well for something like that. What we have also, though, a lot of in Oregon is dispersed livestock grazing, dispersed cattle on large forest allotments. Then flattery and some of these other techniques just would not be very appropriate. They're very, very challenging in those. So some situations, I guess the bottom line is, are more protectable and others are less.
Have you ever worked? I'm sorry. Go ahead.
The depredation slide that you showed, where it was four incidents within a 6 month period, does that apply to one livestock owner, or is that within a certain area?
Right.
What if one livestock owner has a huge amount of land?
Good question. It actually doesn't apply to the livestock owner. It applies to the wolf. Wolf or known wolf or wolves is how the rule reads. And so it's the pack or whatever wolves we know are there. It could be on, and most of the time will be on, different livestock producers. So the Omnaha pack, for example, covers about 1,000 square mile area, depredates in a number of areas. As long as it's the same wolves, that's the wolves are the unit then. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Russ, you used an interesting choice of terminology at the beginning when you talked about wolves and the reintroduction into Oregon. I worked for the forest industry, and I dealt with the Washington issue.
Right.
And that word introduction really sets off a lot of people's ire when you talk about that. And I tend to think of it in terms of reoccupancy. I don't believe that the Department of Oregon Fish and Wildlife is doing any reintroduction of wolves. They're just naturally letting the animals reoccupy.
That's correct.
Have you found that a lot of arguments or conflict can be resolved by changing the tone or the choice of words?
Yes, but I do want to make one thing that's very clear, and it's a well-taken point. When I was speaking of reintroduction, I was talking about the Northern Rocky Mountain reintroduction of wolves into Yellowstone and the Frank Church Wilderness. That's where they were brought down from Canada, reintroduced into those areas. The wolves that we have, no wolf, and I can't be clear enough about this, no wolves have ever been brought into Oregon. All of these wolves that we have came on their own accord from that reintroduced population. So I do want to be very clear, and I try to avoid that to make sure there's no misunderstanding. But and a lot of people do use the word occupy, and that's fair enough. But it is important for people to understand we've made a tacit decision not to bring wolves into the state of Oregon. Of course, at the time, experts said you don't have to because they're going to come anyway, and we now know that they were right. So. Yep, good. It's a point well taken, yes.
When you're investigating a depredation, what are some of the things you're looking for to identify that it's been a wolf and not a different
predator? Yeah, great question. What do we look for in a depredation? It's a long answer, and it's really, as much as it's caused all my gray hairs and it's a really horrible subject, I am fascinated by it. One of the things that we know about wolves is they do prey on animals differently than other large carnivores. And so, regardless of some of the things that we have seen in various types of media over the years, wolf depredation is relatively, not always, but relatively easy to identify. And it's easy to identify mostly because of the way wolves kill. Wolves aren't ambush or dominating predators. So a cougar, a bear might be like is a very top dominated predator. They dominate an animal, literally overpower the animal from the top usually. You see bites on the top of the animal. And it happens fairly quick. Cougars are ambush predators, so they ambush an animal, they kill it very quick, a lot of times by suffocating or severing. So it happens quick, and it's very surgical. Wolves are an entirely different beast. Wolves kill by what I often refer to as multiple bite trauma. They run along these animals and they bite them. And sometimes you watch the videos of wolves biting like an elk or whatever it's biting, a bison, and it almost looks innocuous. It almost looks like they're just nipping, but they're not. They're creating an incredible amount of damage that isn't even visible underneath. And what happens is wolves kill by biting enough times to where the animal goes into shock, usually stops or slows down, then it's pretty easy to kill. The reason I say that then is because of that, all you have to do is, if you have very much of an animal left, skin the animal, pull the hide off of, say, a cow, for example, or a sheep, and the evidence is just plain as day underneath, more than any other animal, because they do such incredible trauma. It'd be a horrible way to get killed, I assure you. But they do such great trauma. So when we can look at canine tooth spacing, we can see the scrape marks on these animals. We can look at the locations. Wolves almost always attack soft spots. They'll attack right here. Virtually every adult cow and almost all calves that we have, and most elk, will have bites right here in the armpit. They'll run along the side and they'll nail them here in their groin area, on the back of the ham area, and even up underneath in the stomach area. So they're attacking soft spot. And those are the places that are highly vascular, and that's where you create the most damage with the least amount of risk. So they don't, and because of that, it's actually pretty easy to tell. I will caveat that by saying one thing. The other thing, though, that can make it hard to tell that it's a wolf kill, because oftentimes a wolf pack can make short work of an animal and there's not anything left. So a lot of times they eat the evidence. So all carnivores do, of course, but wolves can do it pretty quickly. So a lot of the difficulty in our ability to tell what killed an animal is related to the length of time the animal's been dead and how much of it's been consumed. If it's a lot's been consumed, it can be hard. If the animal's there, which it is in many cases, or a great portion of it, it's actually fairly easy to tell wolf predation.
Thank you.
Yeah.
How do Oregon's open range laws come into play when you're thinking about the reimbursement and deciding depredation and dealing with the four depredations within 6 months?
Yeah. We use a term, how the open range laws, and in other words, when our livestock are where they're supposed to be and things like that, when it comes to compensation and predation, we use a term called lawfully occupied. In other words, the animal is private. The animal is privately owned, even if it's on a public land allotment. So the damage is to a private entity, a cow, for example. So open range laws, and Oregon has open range law, it really doesn't come into play as long as we would consider the animals lawfully occupying that area. So if a cow or a sheep or whatever the livestock we're talking about that's been attacked, as long as it's there because it's supposed to be there, then it all applies, this all applies.
But doesn't that create a conundrum? Because you have a cow walking around where there are elk, where there's everything else that wolves prey on, and the wolves don't know which one to go towards or not.
Well, you're right there. Wolves don't know, and wolves don't understand private property boundaries or public land grazing allotments. You're exactly right, and that's a tough
thing. Couldn't there be some, I guess it just seems, you're interesting in terms of property laws and
right.
compensation if you have all this open space. And
right.
Oregon made a it's a good point and well taken. Oregon made a tacit decision years ago to say we're not going to differentiate. There's not good depredation and bad depredation. Meaning, it's bad if wolves depredate on private property, but on public land they're allowed to do a little more. We did not make that distinction. A cow is a cow regardless of the ownership that it's on. So that's kind of the basis that we work on. And of course, there's some people that don't agree with that and others that do.
Are they
reading?
What's apis?
Well,
roll?
Go ahead, one and then I'll.
Oh, what is apis roll on the depredation?
I couldn't hear that.
Apis, the U.S. Fish and Wildlife, USDA, apis.
Yeah, Wildlife Services, which is the agency that you're referring to, is in Oregon. Not all counties have a Wildlife Services agent, but we work with Wildlife Services on all of these. Right now, they're undergoing a process, so they're not really able to do lethal control or take some of those types of actions with wolves in Oregon today. That could change if they go through the process that they have to go through. But we work with Wildlife Services on a number of these investigations. Yep. There was one other question over here.
I was questioning about the river lake. When you get paid, what if a bear kills your cow? Do you get paid for that?
No.
You don't? Only if wolf?
Only if wolf, yep. Wolf is the only animal in Oregon that we pay or that there is any sort of compensation for loss. So.
Is there any plan on eliminating the number of wolves? Or you say they're doubling about every year. Do you have a maximum in mind?
No.
There's no maximum. We don't have our wolf plan essentially has phases which are based on population. Seven breeding pairs is phase three. That's really considered our management phase. But one of the things we never did was set a cap or a limit of them. I think the wolves will certainly, just as they are in other, there is a limit to wolves. And that doesn't preclude management down the road. It doesn't preclude, but it doesn't say we're going to try to keep wolves at this number or under. Certainly there's going to be places in Oregon where wolves will probably do fairly well and other places where they won't do very well. And so I think there's a bit of a natural balance there as well.
Yes? The services, the Fish and Wildlife Service, their decision about delisting, just mm-hmm. federally delisting the species, is that, like their recovery goals that they have are pretty specified, but isn't some of that based on state management plans?
Yeah, good question, and a complex one, and a complex answer. Yes, it does. There is provisions, essentially one of the things that they, and I can't speak too much to their prospect, one of the things they have to consider is protective mechanisms that are in place, and often those are the state plans. And so in fact, in Oregon, when the delisting proposal came up, really that they use Oregon's plan is to say Oregon, and we support that, Oregon will manage wolves. That's one of the reasons why the state of Oregon supports federal delisting, because we believe we have a plan that really manages wolves and conserves wolves and does all the same thing. So, yep, it's a good question. Really, the Fed's delisting criteria in a lot of the states is not all that different. There's a few different subtle differences. One of them is they are considering taxonomy, the taxonomy question, a lot more than the state are. The state of Oregon, through our program, or through our plan, pretty much just says we'll manage the wolf that we have, whatever wolf that is. We'll manage a gray wolf. Yep.
Russ, what does your gut tell you the differences a PhD student might find between, say, interactions between wolves and cougars here in Oregon versus what's been found, say, Tony Roos' work in Greater Yellowstone, or recently Howard Quigley's work in Jackson?
Good question. It would be hard for me. I don't know. I think you go into these, try to make sure that you're doing it for the right reason, is to find what that answer is. I do believe wolves and cougars, there's been enough to show interaction, and there is probably some controlling or limiting effects on cats. And because of that, I do have to say, and because of some of the other work that we've done that shows how important cougars are, I think there is the potential then, at least, to see real impact on, when we see wolves and cougars interacting, impact on those cat populations. I think we have very high cat populations. So, but at the same time, you can't really predict ahead of time. Really, what we're talking about is are wolves an additive source of mortality for these ungulates, or is it might be compensated by other mechanisms such as fewer cougars? Some areas in Idaho, people have known or showed at some level anyway, when wolves are in an area, there's fewer cougars. The cougars move out. Well, cougars eat meat too. So if they're not there, then you start to see a balancing. And really, that's what don't know if that'll happen or if that's what we'll see, but at least you're looking to see what that effect is. Yep. Well, you've all been a great audience, and I very much appreciate it. We'll ask one more question. A hand came up, and then
does Odie and Debbie have a plan for the ungulate population?
I'm sorry?
Does Odie and Debbie have a plan for the ungulate population with cougars?
Well, we do. OFW has mule deer plans and bear plans and cougar plans and elk plans, and essentially we have objectives in every unit.
Are they adjusting that with wolves, or?
Well, not necessarily. It's just a management numbers for those ungulates, for those elk, for example. So take a unit, best way for me, I always talk best in examples. Take a unit like the Imnaha unit, be a good one. We have an objective elk population that we try to manage for. Right now, that population is actually over that number. So we're trying as an agency to reduce that elk population. Of course, wolves set up in the area, we'll see what happens. I think it's been new enough, we can't really detect a great deal of change. But it is interesting how wolves might actually become part of this as well. At the same time, we're actually trying to reduce that population, and a lot of that's forgotten in some of this wolf stuff. Yep. Not all units are that way. Some units are below objective as well, so we're trying to make more. Well, thanks again. I appreciate all the great questions, fantastic questions, and the discussion. So thank you.